Jan and Josephine, great to have you on stage.
Thank you for having us.
Where are you from?
Maybe I'll kick it off. So Neonix is a Belgian startup. So we're based in Antwerp, and we're active in Belgium and the Netherlands. So
cool. And you, Jan, you work at Basics, also from Belgium?
Yes, Basics is a Belgian-based contractor, but active internationally. So we are active in 25 countries besides Belgium. And we do construction activity, but also concessions, which is more, industrial real estate. And I would say also private real estate. So that's Basics.
Yeah, cool. Hey, Josephine, to start off with you, who is Neonix? What is your value proposition? And what is the link with BIM and the digital twins?
Okay, actually what we do, we have a team of experts in information management and really focused on construction and engineering real estate projects. And what we have seen in the market is that information is quite scattered. If you see a built asset or a built tunnel or bridge or a building, we see from the different life cycle stages that information is all around in different tools, and it's really difficult to have real insight in that asset information. So what we have done, we have built a digital twin register, as we call it, the static pillar of a digital twin that gathers information from different sources throughout that complete asset life cycle. So for us, that is actually to be the starting point to be, let's say, smart building or digital twin ready from day one. So we want to be the single source of truth to start doing smart things.
Yeah, that sounds great. And you're working obviously together with Basics on this.
Yeah.
Jan, who is Basics and what is the importance of BIM and the digital twin for a large international contractor like you? And what are you doing with BIM and digital twins today?
So I think what diversifies Basics from a lot of other contractors, I'm not saying we're unique, but there are not so many other contractors that have an in-house engineering department. And we are about 200 people preparing our projects, whether it's in design or in methods and those kind of things. And we have offices in Brussels, obviously, but also in Dubai and in Brisbane, Australia. And that's really something which has been at the core of our company since the beginning, is that besides our execution and our construction capabilities, we also want to bring technical expertise to our clients. And so in that sense, since over about 10 years now, almost 15 even, we have embraced and followed all the different developments that came across in BIM, which is a container thing. We can come back to that in I think the next questions, but we have embraced that development in the industry. Although the return on investment of those kind of things was not assured and at a certain time even problematic, we still embrace it because what we think is we are convinced that a better control of a design and of the risks and of the information linked to a construction project creates value on the long term for us, for ourselves, of course, but also for our clients, and mainly for the client that becomes the asset owner of the things we build. Mm-hmm. And the same goes actually for digital twin, which you could call a BIM next level. And like pointed out by Josephine, we have an ever stronger focus as a construction company in what we deliver to, which eventually becomes the asset manager, and a good view on its asset, a digital twin of the assets he is operating and who is owning, really creates value, certainly in a connected world with IoT, which we will come back to later. But that's the reason why we do it. It's because we believe that our industry must embrace those new technologies.
But we will come back to for sure later on, and we dive in deeper. But if I may ask you, is the value for BIM or digital twin, is that also being recognized during the construction phase, or is it more in the asset management phase?
I think the value is in all phases of a project, to ask to your question, but I think the biggest value to gain is in the operate phase. And that's something we have learned over the last few years while using it. Yes, we use it to do interface management. Yes, you do it to have better views on information we need while constructing.
Yeah.
But the real value of a digital twin comes in the operation phase of the asset, which is the longest phase. So the benefit remains for quite some time.
Yeah. And I think the biggest challenge with that is actually that you need to think about being digital twin or BIM or smart building ready from day one. And of course, that engineering is actually in the complete beginning of the life cycle of that building. So that is a little bit of the challenge and the balance that we see happening now also in the industry. So,
yeah, and the challenge is probably also that you have like different kind of people that are responsible for those different kind of phases.
Of course.
So how do you get them all aligned, and how can you get them all into that same BIM or digital twin model? And how is the model also going from the starting point till the operation phase? Yeah, that's the biggest challenge probably. How does Neonex look at simple digital twin because BIM is not ready yet? And how does Neonex technology add value?
Yeah, I think. For us, this is not a question one or the other. If we look at the challenges that we see in the market today, if you are an operator or asset owner, contractor, engineering company, or even as an end user of a building, we see that everybody is looking to increase user experience. Is it for external end users or internal end users, different stakeholders? So everybody is looking, how can we improve that experience? And on the other hand, you see that everybody is looking into a way that you can increase the added value of the asset throughout that complete life cycle, throughout the different cycles that we have. So if that would, for example, be through using BIM or using simple or complex digital twin, how you want to call it, that really depends on the use case. I think it's really not about the tools, and that's something that we really try to work on with companies that we are involved with. That's not about the tools, but it's really about the reason why you are looking to implement solutions. You have to really look at that process. And that's something that we provide as our expertise, is that we believe in standardizing information. You talked about how can we get everything connected, because we have all of those stakeholders that have different roles. But by standardizing information, you can actually create the possibility to connect the different life cycles and stakeholders. And that is what we are doing within the Annex portal, is securing that information is standardized and can be reused even if you get into another phase of the building. And then you can start thinking about all those smart use cases. So we want to make sure that you know the asset inside out, but based on international open standards.
Yeah, very interesting. And Jan, how does BASIC see that? Because I can imagine that if you have all those BIM models and you digitalize all those things in a digital twin, you probably see also changes in being an asset owner or a constructor because of those use cases that you have. How do you see that?
Well, our vision, because that's what drives us in these ventures. Our vision is that structure and accessible data, and those two words are important. It needs to be structure and accessible, is the most important digital enabler for a more sustainable and future-proof industry. So that's really the vision we put forward, and I think we are aligned on that with an increasing number of players in the industry. And it's important to keep that in mind, because that is what drives us and energizes us. And I will give two very tangible examples of to what this could lead. So, for example, a database of a digital twin database of existing assets with a detailed material passport is a needed underlayer towards a more circular economy. Because if you want to have impact in the circular economy, the waste of an asset which has come to the end of his life could become the raw material of the new built asset. And such a material bank platform is to construction what Airbnb is to leisure. So you need to know what is available in order to be able to use it. And that's where I think the digital underlayer of digital twins can be the enabler of a more circular and therefore sustainable industry. The second example, material bank, it's more statical data. And let me also give an example about dynamic data like IoT or sensor data, which is real-time data. So a digital asset register that also shares that dynamic data is an enabler for better energy management. And the increased use of renewables that are produced locally can by using the data of the building be better, have a more impact, because you can use the inertia of the assets, like big water tanks, which are in a lot of assets. You could use that inertia to create heat at moments that your renewables produce a lot, but you don't use. And if you don't have digital twins, if you don't have structured data, you cannot achieve that goal. So it's really a digital underlayer to create a more sustainable industry from construction to asset management.
Yeah. How do you see the role with NEA next, and what does they do for you in this whole digital twin BIM proposition?
Well, Neonix is created, and Josephine said it, that I don't know if it came true, but it's based on international standards. So the way data is exchanged between different applications is standardized. And therefore, you can use that as a single source of truth in which all these applications go and get the unique data, and you always know that you use the unique data, whether it's statical data or whether it's dynamic data. And that's why we believe that, and that's also why we invested, and I can comment or I can answer questions in the Q&A later on that. That's also one of the reasons why I invested, because they saw the importance, and it's something that we have learned in our project. They saw the importance of structured data using international standards, so that exchange of data becomes much more easier.
Yeah, amazing. And at Neonix, what is your vision on digitalization, the digitalization race?
Yeah, I think that's quite connected with what Jan was just saying about the creating, using the open standards to make sure that you can exchange information. That is really embedded in our philosophy, based on two things. Is one, we really believe in the value of a best of breed principle. So if you base the way you structure and you use information on that open standards, you can actually be flexible to use tools that are specifically really strong for specific use cases. If we see international companies that go for principles for vendor lock-in and have a complete product stack, that doesn't give flexibility to those end users that we were talking about, or that doesn't give possibilities if you start working with other tools, if you have other use cases, to be flexible and to reuse that information. So that best of breed principle is one thing that really drives us. Be the best in your use case and what you are doing, but also involve in creating that ecosystem. It's not about ecosystems to network. That's also important, Wouter, but it's also about creating the ecosystem in the digitalization. And again, based on those open standards, you can actually connect with any kind of tool or use case that also is able to comply to those open standards. So for example, what we are doing with an Horizon 2020 project is actually looking at creating a digital twin open API standard. So that creates maturity and gives possibility to connect to any kind of use case or tool that complies to that standard. So in our belief, I think the company that are open to collaboration and creating ecosystems, they will survive or will be the best to change the way they are working.
But do you see like a collaboration coming up, or do you see also like an consolidation coming up? The big players are coming, taking over the smaller players.
Yeah, I think in the end, the most flexible and agile companies will be able to survive. And of course, you will have some consolidation, because you see now, it's always the thing with some trends that are coming up. Everybody's trying to find their way into that ecosystem. But I think the collaboration for us is the most important thing. And not a consolidation. So I think that, and we believe strongly that that will be the case.
Cool. Well, Jan, maybe the last question for you. As construction, we are known as the most, maybe the most conservative industry. But you guys, of course, are setting the pace, if I may believe what you all do. How do you see the future of construction? What is the nice things that you see for us? For our industry,
well, I can't predict the future. But what I think, what is for me a fact, and the only question is at which pace. And I think the pace will be faster than a lot of people think in the Easter Sphere, because there is just a need. I think we have we are making the industry more sustainable is what will drive us the coming 10 to 20 years. The generation that now joins the construction industry, they push us like crazy to become more sustainable. They love the industry, but they're fed up to read that we are responsible for 40% of the waste, 40% of the greenhouse gases. So the younger generation,
they push forward.
Yeah, and of course, what happens in the world? Climate change is a reality. We can see. So I really think that we are in an era of becoming a more sustainable industry, whether it's in respect to materials, whether it's in respect to upcycling and recycling. And I am convinced, and that's one of the reasons why we invested in Neonix, and was not for a fast return on investment, and it has proven to be a right assumption, by the way, but that's not, we are convinced that that digitization is the enabler for a more sustainable industry. And so to respond to your question, sustainability. And I call upon all those in those calls, and I tell this to my client, public or private, please challenge us on sustainability, and don't choose the contractor who has only the lowest price. Choose the contractor who creates the more sustainable solutions. I think that's what should drive us. And I think network like yours, Wouter, they have an important role to play there, because we need to repeat that message.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, our tagline is always to use technology to create a better built environment. And I think that really matches with the implementing sustainability as much as you said it. Sustainability. So thank you very much. Thank you, Josephine. And thank you, Jan.